Musonius Rufus, from amongst the Stoics, says also, it is in constantly paying attention to oneself that one assures one's salvation. Or Seneca, you must attend to your soul, attend to yourself, lose no time doing so. Retire into yourself and stay there. Dio of Prusa gives one lecture over to the necessity of an eis eoton anachoresis, a retreat into oneself. And Galen, recalling how much time it is necessary to train a doctor, an orator, or a grammatician, thinks that even more time is necessary to become a good man. Years and years, he says, spent in occupying yourself with yourself. Epictetus, in one of his diatribae, gives this definition of human being. Man is this unique kind of beings on the earth who have to take care of themselves. Nature has provided animals with everything they need. Humans don't have the same natural equipment, but we must understand that the necessity of taking care of ourselves is also a supplementary gift which has been bestowed. God has confided us to ourselves, giving us by this means the possibility and the duty of being free. For Epictetus, the epimeleia heotou, which is ontologically linked to human finitude, is the practical form of freedom. And it is by taking care of himself that human being becomes similar to God, God who has nothing else to do than taking care of himself. For us now, the notion of epimeleia heotou is faded and obscure. It seems to have been covered over either by the Socratic precept, gnoti seoton, or by the Christian principles of asceticism, which implies renouncing to oneself, to that extent that if we are asked what was the most important moral principle and the most characteristic in ancient philosophy, the answer which comes immediately to mind is not epimele seoto, take care of yourself, but, as you know, gnothi seoton, know yourself. Perhaps our philosophical and historical tradition has somehow overrated the importance of the gnoti seoton, of the know yourself. One must remember that the rule of having to know oneself was, in fact, and in the ancient culture, constantly associated with that of concerning oneself with oneself. And more than that, to know oneself was considered as a means for taking care of oneself. And when we consider Christian asceticism, we are used to underscore the rule of renouncing oneself, and we forget that in the spiritual experience of some early Christians like Gregory of Nyssa, renouncing oneself was a way of taking care of oneself, or at least a new form of the old philosophical epimeleia eoutou. And I think that we have to be aware that those two great figures of the Western experience of the self-knowledge and asceticism, those two great figures are rooted in this multi-secular tradition of the care of the self, the care of the self being at the same time in the Greco-Roman culture a notion, a precept, an attitude, and a technique, a practical matrix for the experience of the self. Most of the historians of ancient philosophy are concerned with the rise of ontology and metaphysics from Parmenides to Aristoteles through Plato. Most of the historians of Greek sciences are interested in the rise of rational thought through mathematics and cosmology. I think it could be valuable to study also the rise of a certain type of subjectivity, of a certain type of relation to oneself in this Greco-Latin culture of the self. Greek metaphysics has been determinant for our philosophical relationship to being. Greek science has been determinant for our rational relationship to the world. The Greco-Roman culture of the self has been, I think, determinant for our ethical relationship to ourselves. And my dream would be, if I could find people interested in the same topics, to start an historical analysis of those techniques of the self in the Western societies from the beginning of the Greek civilization. My intention tonight is to present you a very brief survey of some aspects of this culture of the self in the Greek and in the Greco-Roman civilization. And I'll take only two views on this culture of the self, one in the fourth century before Christ and the other on the two first centuries of our era. It has been sometimes said that the culture of the self in the Greco-Roman society was linked to the decay of the old political and social structures, the decline of the cities, the decline of the old and traditional aristocracies, the development of autocratic regimes, the increasing importance of private life could have been factors for the rise of a so-called individualism. But my hypothesis is that those historical processes, if they really took place, may have produced some changes in the culture of the self, but they are not, by themselves, the reason for the high value attributed to the care of the self. And this care of the self is very well known and very highly valued since at least the fourth century before Christ. For instance, following at least Plutarch, a king of Sparta, when he was asked by someone why Spartans did not cultivate their land by themselves, but let the islots do the job for them, this king of Sparta gave this answer: the reason why we do not cultivate our land is that we prefer to take care of ourselves. And in Xenophon, in the Cyropaedia, we see Cyrus, a model of a great king and a good man, following Xenophon. We see Cyrus coming back in his palace after several great victories and conquests, and he meets his old friends and companions and asks them, "Well, what shall we do now?" And Cyrus himself gives the answer. The answer is not, "Well, I'll take care or we'll take care of the new empire," he says, "and now that we have won victory, we have to take care of ourselves." The culture of the self is not a late phenomenon due to the decline of the classical city. It was an early phenomenon, and it took in the antiquity several forms. The first philosophical elaboration of the principle "you must concern with yourself with yourself" is found in a dialogue written by Plato in the Alcibiades. The Neoplatonists considered that this dialogue had to be the first in the collection of Plato's works. Albinus, a Neoplatonist of the second century after death, said that every naturally gifted young man who has reached the age of philosophizing and practicing virtue should begin by studying the Alcibiades. And Proclus considered this dialogue as the Arche Apaces Philosophias, means the principle and point of departure for all philosophy, because this dialogue teaches people to get concerned with themselves.